Hi, Florette here. Thanks so much for joining me today. I'm super excited because this is the first Coloring with Ink on 3 here at the Stamp and Scrapbook Expo at home. We're gonna have some fun. I'm gonna show you a lot of tips, tricks, and techniques for all kinds of coloring. So let's get started and get your ink on. I think you'll really enjoy this and find it really helpful. I'm going to show you 3 different stamping techniques and 3 different ways you can watercolor using those techniques. The first one I'm showing you here is using embossing ink. The second one is using a standard black ink for most stamping that you're going to see. That's what you're most used to seeing. It's probably the second easiest way to watercolor. And this is a great way to lead up to the third style, and which is my absolute favorite, is no line coloring. And here we stamp this one with the Fade Out No Line Coloring ink. It's a magical ink that will make the process really easy. And I'll be going through each one of these step by step, but it's going to be really fun and great way to learn how to watercolor. I thought I'd start with my absolute favorite, and that's no line coloring. The reason I love it so much is it gives you this beautiful stamped image that actually winds up looking like a watercolor painting. It will no longer look like a stamp. We're using the Fade Out No Line Coloring Ink. It's the original No Line Coloring Ink. It's just a magical ink that actually absorbs the color you lay on top. It's not a tan, it's not a gray, it's actually completely neutral, and you can use warm and cool colors on it, which makes No Line Coloring super, super easy. Of course, with any new technique, you are going to have to practice a little bit, but this ink truly makes it fun and simple. If you follow the techniques I'm going to show you here, you're going to come up with beautiful results and you're going to take your coloring to a whole new level. So I have a water brush pen, but I actually do not have any water in the barrel. The only reason I don't have water in the barrel is because it's a very tiny image and I really want to make sure to control how much water I'm putting on the paper. So you'll notice I have an ink off cloth on my mat and I have a little piece of tile that I use to dab the ink on so that I can see what the color is. But the ink off cloth will keep my brush from getting too wet. One of the biggest tips I can give you for all watercoloring is to make sure to not use too much water. So many times people struggle because they're actually just using too much water. You really just want a barely damp brush. What I've been doing as we've been chatting is I started out very light and I just kind of mapped out where I was going to have my shadows and left some of the lines untouched. And then I just blended that ink out to get a very light wash over the little bird's head, wing, and tail. Now I'm coming back in and adding some more color on top. I can layer these colors and then continue to build. That's the thing about watercolors. It is easier if you start light and then continue to build the colors on top of each other to get that depth and dimension. You'll notice I dab the cloth onto my actual little painting every once in a while, and that's because maybe I got a little too much water on there. So don't be afraid to take your cloth and dab it on, and it'll just pull up that excess water. But you can see I'm just blending out as we go along, and now I'm just going to add a little more color into the little corners to create more depth. And as you do that, you're going to get a lot more roundness to your image. It's going to make it a little more lifelike and just give that nice depth that we're all looking for. So if you think about no line coloring as basically you're just tracing the lines and filling in the color. If you think of it that way, it's really easy and not difficult at all. But their end result is going to look like this amazing painting and everyone's going to think you spent hours and hours on it. But a little bird image like this really only takes about 10 minutes. So I've gotten a base for the head, the little wing, and the tail. Now I'm going to move on to the chest of the bird. To watercolor this section, I'm using the Atelier Paint It Black. But the thing about it is when I add water to it, it's going to dilute the color a bit. If I were to stamp with this ink, I'm going to get a really nice black. But if I watercolor with it, I'm going to get a really pretty gray. And the amazing part is you're going to get these beautiful undertones of like a peachy pink. So it's going to give you the results of a professional artist without having to do all the work. You only need one color, but you're going to get a couple colors out of it. So you're going to have all these beautiful undertones that come out.
At this point, you're only really seeing the gray, but as it dries, you're going to wind up seeing the undertones of some browns, some peachy, and some pink, along with the nice gray color. And so that's the other thing. When you're no-line coloring, let the piece dry, let sections dry, and then go look at it again, and then you can add more layers. And the really nice thing about doing a little piece like this is it will dry really quickly. But you can always use a heat gun if you want to speed up the process a little bit. You'll also notice that I'm leaving some white space in the middle, and that's going to leave you some really nice highlights. And then I'm going to go and just kind of blend things around. The other great thing about Atelier is it gives you a lot of working time. So if you, say, have some water marks or something like that, you can go back in with a little more water and dab it off or blend it out. So you can always go back and continue to work on it and to get it exactly how you like it. You can let sections dry and then go back and add more tones. So it really is very flexible and easy to work with. One of the amazing things about the Fade Out No Line Coloring Ink is the way it grabs the media we lay on top. So as I run my brush along these tiny little sections, that ink is going to grab the Atelier watercolor that we're putting on top. So it makes the process a lot easier. I can do all kinds of detailed images and get these really beautiful little paintings. Here's a really nice tip. If you perhaps didn't leave all your white space, or you have some extra lines that you want to blend out more, you can grab some of the Shark Tooth White and blend it over the areas or give some highlights. So if you lose some of your white space, don't worry about it. You can add the highlights later, and you can see I'm just dipping my brush right into the Shark Tooth White ink pad and then dabbing it onto little sections and blending it out, and it's giving me these beautiful little highlights and this really soft, pretty look. Now I used my Misty stamping positioning tool, and I left my little bird stamp in the Misty so that I could re-stamp it if I wanted to. Now I did notice I couldn't see my little eye as well because of how far away I was, so I decided to re-stamp it. That's what's really great with Fade Out ink as well. I can stamp over it to find that little eye, and then I just took a little liner pen and put the eye back on. Oh, now look at that. Isn't that so pretty? You can now start to see, as it's drying, those beautiful pinks and browns and peachy colors. Isn't that so pretty? So then I decide to go back and add a little more highlights. This little bird could have been done, but I always like to fiddle with it a little more and add little highlights or add extra darkness here and there to give it more depth and dimension. The other thing I like to do once it's dry is I like to look at it and see if there's any other areas I want to blend a little more. And that's what I'm doing here. I'm doing some blending. I'm adding a little more white to sections and some highlights. And then a lot of times I'll step back and look at it and see what I think. But I just think this little bird looks absolutely adorable. It looks like a mini little painting. I also wanted to show you how easy it is to paint flowers, because I know I like to paint flowers. Everybody loves to paint flowers. So I thought I'd show you how to also do some florals as well. So what I did first on this floral, because it's a larger section, is I took my brush, and this is called Wet on Wet, and I took a light coating of water and just brushed it all over the petal. So clear water without any pigment. Then after it was wet, I dipped into some sweet petunia pink and added the color to the edges where I want the shadows, and then I took some clear water and blended that out. So I wanted to give a little drying time between the petals so that when I go back, I can do the wet on wet technique. So I decide I'll do the leaves first. And for that, I just dipped into the green and the yellow and blended the two colors together. And you can see that Atelier ink with the fade out, and the fade out is actually grabbing the color and keeping all the details. So that's making it really easy for me to do. And the Atelier inks blend beautifully together so that I get this really nice soft blend. So now I'm moving back to the petals. I added some clean, clear water. Then I'm grabbing some of the pink and going along the edges and where I might have my shadows, and then blending that out. And remember, don't worry too much about this part or if you have any jagged lines or anything like that. This is just our first layer. We're mapping out where we want our shadows and where we want our highlights. And you can see I put the dark at the base of my petals and then pull the colors up. Now I decide to grab my heat gun and just dry it a little bit. If you go outside the lines, you can just dab some clean, clear water on it, grab your cloth and dab it up, and that will correct anything that you go outside of the lines. I could set this aside and let it dry, but I'm going to just hit it with my heat gun so I can go right on to my second layer. Of course, you can do all the techniques I'm showing you here with regular watercolors as well. The reason I like to use Atelier is because it gives me a lot of working time, plus it gives me the ability to correct any mistakes that I see. It's just very, very flexible and gives you a lot of working time. It's just a very forgiving ink. The other thing I didn't mention is it has a lot of pigment. It is an artist grade ink at a very, very affordable price. So it's really great and easy to use. And I can also use it for all kinds of other techniques. I can stamp with it, I can emboss with it, you name it. It really is a all-in-one ink. You can see now all the depth and dimension we're getting by just adding a second layer. So I added the color exactly where I did the first time, but as I add layer after layer, those sections are going to get a little darker each time so you can build upon your colors. So now you can see I did still leave the white space in there, and that's going to give us those beautiful highlights and lowlights. Another tip I wanted to give you in order to keep that beautiful white space and also keep your dark pigment at the bottom is when you add that dark color at the base, you're going to just start pulling it up from where the color meets the white space. You're just going to blend those two areas together so that you keep that dark, dark shadows at the bottom. So the stamp set we use today is really a Simply No Line stamp set, and it has these great little stamens that you can lay back into your flower so you don't have to worry about watercoloring those teeny tiny little stamen pieces. You can just stamp it on after you're done coloring your flowers. Now look at that. Isn't that so pretty? So now we've done the no line coloring. We're going to move into the next one, which is stamping with a black ink. I'm using the Blackout ink, which is waterproof. It's a hybrid ink. It dries really fast and it's not going to smudge, and it's also archival, so you can even use it for scrapbooking or alcohol marker. So it's a very versatile ink. So this coloring technique is a little bit easier than the one we did before, and you're just going to dip into your ink and start coloring in the lines. I still like to use the base areas to create my shadows and then pull the color out. It's a great way to practice watercoloring before you move on to trying no line coloring. You can also use it as a practice piece before you no line color the little bird. I can then map out my shadows and map out my highlights using this. But it's also just a great way to do a really quick little coloring piece for a card or a scrapbook or a tag or anything like that. So because we're watercoloring, I usually like to lay down a nice wash of color first, and here we're laying our lightest color down, we're blending it out, and then once this is dry, we're going to go back and add some more depth and dimension. But for this, I'll just add a little color, grab some clean, clear water, and you'll notice I always dip on my ink off cloth because, again, one of the biggest tips I can give you for watercoloring is less water. We really only need a barely damp brush, and you're going to have much better results. You're going to be much happier. You're going to say, oh my gosh, this is so much easier. All I had to do was use less water. And I always like to have that nice light layer to start with and build upon it. So just take your time and really enjoy the process and keep blending at this point. And which keep in mind that you also want to keep the white space so that you have those highlights. Now here you can see I went outside my line and I added a little water to the edge, grabbed my cloth and dabbed it off, and it magically disappeared. Isn't that great? So if you go outside the lines, don't get all stressed out. Just dab it off and you'll be good to go. So now once I have done the breast area of the bird, I can move back to the head and the other parts because those will be dry, and I'll add my second layer, and you can see I have those nice deep dark shadows in there. The other thing, if you go outside the lines, you can use a gel pen, which I did there. I used a little white gel pen to go around the edges. That's another thing you can use to correct anything. But once I add that deep dark shadow in there, I'm just going to blend it out. Now that was really easy. So now we're going to go on to the easiest way to start watercoloring. So for this last technique, I use the Juicy Watermark Embossing Ink and some embossing powder. And then I'm just going to heat that up after it's stamped. And you can see there, and you can see the image is white, kind of hard to see. But as we add the color, the lines where we put the embossing powder are going to act like wells, and they're going to keep the color in the lines for you. So it's a little bit easier way to start watercoloring. Now you could use a black embossing powder if you wanted to. I chose white because it kind of gives you that no line coloring look without being actually no line coloring, if that makes sense. But you can see here I'm just really rolling the paint right over the image, and I have those white embossed lines that's just keeping the paint inside. So not only is this a great way to get the feel of watercolors and how they move, it's also a great way to create a really, really quick image to pop on a card or a tag or anything like that. It's probably going to be the fastest way to color a little stamp. But you can see here, I did the same thing. I did the little head, the wing, and the tail first, and I'm keeping my white spaces and then adding the lightest color wash over the whole thing. And then I'm going to go back and add some depth to it by layering the colors as they dry. And as I go along, I dip, always dipping my paintbrush in my clean, clear water and dabbing it off of my cloth to make sure to not have too much water. So I grab a little bit of yellow and do the beak, and then I'm just going to run the paint it black right over the twig, and you can see how quickly that worked. And then I'm going to add some little darkness to the outer edges of the bird's chest to give it that depth and dimension. And again, you can see those beautiful undertones coming out. So this is a really, really great place to start, is by using embossing ink and embossing powders, because it keeps the paint inside the lines for you. And then once those areas dry, I'm going to add the little bit of shadow, a little more pigment to it, to give it the deep shadows and the highlights. Now, because we used the white embossing powder, I used a black pen to put the little eye back in there. And then I decided I'm going to put a little bit of tan or brown, twiggy brown, on the beak. And also, because this is a white embossing powder, I decided to put a little bit of yellow around the bird so that you could see him a little bit better, because those, remember, the outside lines on this one are white, so we need something to make him stand out or pop off the page. Now you'll notice I'm able to go around the little bird really quickly, and that's because with embossing, those lines are raised, so I don't have to worry too much. It's pretty easy to not go into the little blue of the bird. Now, once you've watercolored all your images, if you have any mistakes or things you don't like, here's my quick tip. Grab some liquid pixie dust and put a little sparkle on, and it will magically make everything even better. It'll just really make your images pop, and I just love a little sparkle, and liquid pixie dust always does the trick. I can put it in my water brush pen and just simply put it on. And then I'm going to show you all three different little birdies we did, and you'll see how different each one is. So here we have all the little birdies that we did in all the different techniques using the three essential inks. So we have your embossed image, then we have our black lined image. You can see here, that's one look. And then we have the fade out no line coloring look. So the no line coloring with the little bird and the flower and the leaves. Three fun watercoloring techniques.
Thank you so much for joining me for the first episode of Coloring with Ink on Three. I had so much fun. Coloring is absolutely one of my favorite things to do, and I'm so excited to be able to share it with you. So I can't wait to see you again next time. Be sure to check out the Ink on Three social media channels. We have YouTube, Instagram, all kinds of stuff like that. Coloring is absolutely one of my favorite things to do. It's super relaxing, and as you do it, you'll get better and better all all the time. So even if you think you messed up on something, just keep going or put it aside and go look at it later. Sometimes you'll be amazed at how much more you like it when you see it at a later date. I always save some things that I think maybe I didn't do as good on. And then I look at it later, I'm like, oh, that's not so bad. So yeah, save everything you make. And then also you'll see your progress. So thanks so much for joining me. I can't wait to do another one of these coloring videos with you. And I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.